Well, my name's Michael Chorost, and so my claim to fame for the purpose of this conversation is my first book. So this is a memoir that I wrote of going deaf and learning how to hear all over again with the cochlear implant. I actually brought these to Kaplan to get to your team so you can just have these books.
So thank you so much.
Give this to you guys. So I would have brought four, but I didn't have four. Anyway, you can share them among your team. So my background, as I was telling
Jeremy, is
educational technology. So I spent a lot of time thinking about the intersection of technology, education, culture in my own doctoral program. So since then, I've been a freelance science writer. So I've just come out with the second book titled Worldwide Mind, which takes some of the ideas of my first book and raises them to a more general level. Can we actually read brain activity? Can we alter brain activity? Can we use that to communicate? What are the implications? So at this point, I've described myself as essentially an itinerant philosopher. And I write books, give talks, think big thoughts.
Okay. How do we go around the room? Yeah.
Okay. I want to ask you about how has wearing cochlear implants changed your life?
Okay, changing my own life, particularly. Okay, well, all right, so let me give you a little bit of background so you understand what my life was before I got a cochlear implant. So my mother had rubella when she was pregnant with me in 1964. So I was born with severe hearing losses in both ears. That wasn't diagnosed until I was about 3.5 years old. So I got hearing aids at that age. I began to learn spoken language pretty rapidly from that point on. So I learned it well enough. So between ages 3 and 36, I was fully integrated into the hearing world. I did not learn sign language. I was just someone with a hearing loss. But then, on July 7th, 2001, I abruptly lost all the remaining hearing in my one good ear, in my left ear. So I thought my batteries were dying in my hearing aids. It wasn't the batteries, it was my ears that were dying. So shortly thereafter, I got a cochlear implant in my left ear. And about 8 years later, I got another cochlear implant in my right ear. So as for how it changed my life, that's a multi-leveled kind of question. So before, I had always had a life as a person in the hearing world using English as my primary language of communication. So that didn't change. What did change was that the way I heard was completely different. So I now had a computer in my head that was taking in sound from the outside world, digitizing it, feeding it to my auditory nerves. So at first, things sounded completely bizarre. It took me about a year to learn how to hear all over again. So for the first couple of months, I would turn the radio on, and I would hear gibberish. And I had always been a radio listener my whole life. So it sounded like language, but I could not make out a single word. So I had to practice. I had to learn how to hear all over again to map the sounds of language onto words that made sense in my brain. So now I use the phone all the time. I listen to the radio. It was a protracted learning process.
How aware are you of the inner workings of the cochlear implant? And you said you had hearing aids before it. Did you mentioned that there was a little bit of a new learning that had to happen? But the actual inner workings of the technology, how aware are you of that?
Well, let's talk about the inner workings first. So I brought along two cochlear implants to show you guys.
Great.
Yeah, so I'll just hold that up so the camera can get a good look at that. So that's the cochlear implant that I have in my left ear. This is the one that I have in my right ear. So I'll pass them around to you guys so you can look at them. So the one that Ching Ting is holding, that's actually a real cochlear implant. That's not a model. The one that Jeremy is holding is a model. It's not an actual device. So just to start with that, so what you're looking at there in the device itself, so can you slide it back over to me? So let me start with the outside parts, which is what you see in my head. So this is my right cochlear implant processor. So it looks like a hearing aid, but it's not a hearing aid because there's no sound output. A hearing aid just outputs loudly amplified sound. But I'm totally deaf, so no hearing aid in the world will help me. So what this does is it sits in my ear. That's a microphone that takes in sound. This unit here is the processor. This digitizes the sound, converts into a string of ones and zeros. This is a lithium ion battery. This powers the system. So the processor sends a signal to this radio transmitter. And so this is actually beaming a signal of about a million bits per second, ones and zeros, a representation of sound. And what it's beaming to is the implant, which is embedded in my skull. And as you can see, they stick to each other. That's because there are magnets in both of them.
Is it magnetic?
There's a magnet in here, and there's a magnet in here. Okay. So they will stick to each other. So this device is countersunk in my skull underneath my skin. So you can't see it if you just look at the side of my head, because it's completely encased underneath my skin. So this is just sitting there on the top of my skull. The headpiece sticks to it. This picks up the radio signal, and it decides which of the electrodes at the end of this wire to stimulate. So if you look very, very closely at this, you would see 16 tiny platinum iridium electrodes. And the surgeon snakes these into the inner ear. And they strobe on and off, and they trigger various parts of the auditory nerve and recreate a sensation of sound. So this all together is a complete cochlear implant, the internal and the external components. So there are two things here. So this is the one I got in 2001. This is the one I got in 2008. The electronics are actually identical. What is different is that this one is not MRI compatible. Because I have this in my hand, I can't have an MRI because there's a magnet in there.
Oh, okay.
There's no way to get the magnet out. This device has identical electronics, but the magnet is removable. So the surgeon can simply make a small incision in the skin, remove the magnet. The patient can then go in the MRI chamber. And then after the MRI, the surgeon just puts it right back in. Takes a few seconds, and then does a few stitches, and that's it. So this is the antenna that picks up the radio signal. That is where the processing electronics are. And just as with the other device, it terminates in a string of 16 electrodes at the end. So that's the hardware itself. So you asked me how aware I am of the hardware. And I'll pass it back to you so you can actually look at it a little more. So for one thing, I can't physically feel the wires inside my inner ear. I can feel the implant itself. I mean, there's a slight bump in my skull where I can feel the curve of the implant itself. It's a very slight kind of thing. And the headpiece, it sticks. I mean, as you can see, it sticks strongly enough to actually stick to my head. Stupid implant tricks. But it's a very soft pressure. It doesn't abrade my skin. It's not like it clumps on and actually hurts or anything. So when I put it on, I hear this sort of rushing electronic kind of sound as the device boots itself up and begins sending electrical signals to my auditory nerves.